Good afternoon and welcome to this Humane Philosophy Project mini-conference. Firstly, I'd like to thank the Ian Ramsey Centre in general and Andrew in particular for including this event as part of this year's Ian Ramsey Centre conference. The Humane Philosophy Project is very fortunate to be cooperating with the Ian Ramsey Centre on a number of events. This year has seen a series of filmed seminars, speakers at which included Anthony Kenny, Michael Heller, Roger Penrose, and Hubert Dreyfus, among others. And the series is going to continue next year with speakers already invited, including Mary Midgley, Timothy Williamson, and Howard Robinson. And indeed, at the end of the summer, we have a sister conference on the theme of human nature. I'm sure it will be greatly influenced by reflection on some of the issues that were raised here. You can find out about all of this on our website, humanephilosophy.com. So I won't go on about this later, but we're very, very grateful for the Ian Ramsey Centre's support and involvement in the Humane Philosophy Project and hope the cooperation will continue fruitfully. So the Humane Philosophy Project itself is an initiative based at the universities of Oxford and Warsaw, and the other institutions involved include the Institute of Philosophy at the University of Warsaw, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford, and the Dalai Lama Centre for Compassion, Oxford. The aim of the project is to bring philosophy to bear on human concerns about themselves, the world, and their place in it, and accordingly there are three areas being explored, which are the physical world, the human world, and the nature of the being, which is part of the first and which inhabits the second. Now, given the brief character, of course, of this introduction, I cannot give sufficient justification for this focus. So if you missed Ralph's talk from the previous session, I'll provide an illustration which I hope captures how we've envisaged the theme, at least for this particular session. There it is. So the description of this conference, which you have in your conference booklet, points out that humans often name themselves with Latin binominals: Homo sapiens, Homo economicus, Homo scientificus, socialis, liturgicus, and you can go on with Homo faber, ludens, satyr, and so on and so on. These are all descriptions and very apt question posed the information about the theme of this conference is whether such labels are adequate in a post-Darwinian world to capture the complexity of our understanding and to form a bias for a systematic differentiation. Now, an interesting fact to notice about all these descriptions is that they limit themselves to the subject homo, as David Clough pointed out, stealing my line at the start of today's proceedings. And they ascribe to it a distinguishing feature, usually related to some form of individual or group behavior. So this absolute one quality. So for example, with Homo liturgicus, it would be rituals, with Homo faber, work, with Homo ludens, play, and so on. Now, Raymond Tallis, however, and I do realize that bringing Ray and David together in one paragraph is risky business, but perhaps a further example of what the Humane Philosophy Project is about. Raymond Tallis remarked on the first day that approaching human beings through the framework of patterns of behavior is preemptively reductive, as it limits the scope of our understanding of the things which bind our societies and ultimately give meaning to the observable gestures that we can look at from the third person standpoint, as it were. And Aristotle, when attempting to define the human, begins from the fact of our belonging to the animal kingdom and looks for conditions determining human flourishing which give us our specific place in it. His famous and still widely debated concept, politicum tuum, the political animal, points to the fact that we flourish in particular relations with others which are not defined by the behavior involved simpliciter, but by its meaning for the interpersonal context in which they occur. And although Aristotle has been, especially in his Nicomachean and Eudaimonian ethics, heavily individualistic, if not, if you like the term, narcissistic, his emphasis upon personal flourishing, the emphasis upon the personal flourishing he makes, interpersonal relations such as friendship and social virtues are like justice central to his thought. And we thought this would be a good starting point for our speakers to discuss the human difference in an interpersonal context defined by concepts such as dignity or virtue. Now, this might turn out to be a foiled aspiration. Only the speakers themselves are going to be able to prove whether our ambitions were
responsibility.
Yes. So we're going to present a series of talks on three philosophers, Michael Oakeshott, Elizabeth Anscombe, and Thomas Aquinas, from the perspective of what we would call humane philosophy, and we do hope you enjoy them. So without further ado, my colleague Ralph Weir is going to introduce the speakers.
One of the responsibilities of hosts at these things is to take responsibility for the perfidy of technology. So I'll just set up our first speaker's slide for him. Oh, if I can. Well, I said I was going to take responsibility. Instead, I'm going to hand it to Mikwai. I say Mikwai. Could you help me out here? I seem to have lost the mouse pointer. Is that because it's... I was just using the one on
look,
the...
Look. If it's this one, and then, no.
Excellent, yeah. Very good. So I'll just say something about the format. We've got three talks. They're going to last about 20 minutes each, much like the short papers during the parallel sessions, and there'll be about 10 minutes for questions after each of them. This does mean that there's a good chance we'll end slightly early, in which case we'll simply let you go early, but it's also possible if the room is full of burning questions, then we might allow a little time at the very end for questions to be asked to any of our three speakers. I also wanted to say something else about the kind of event we're conducting. So one of the Humane Philosophy Project's aspirations is to re-establish, or perhaps reaffirm, the connection between contemporary philosophy and the broader arts and humanities. So it's very appropriate that we have speaking today one lawyer, one theologian, and one scholar of English literature in a manner quite unusual for what is essentially a philosophy event. So our first speaker is Robert Jan Winters. Robert Jan studied philosophy of law at the University of Leiden, where he graduated cum laude. He now lectures in jurisprudence at the University of Leiden, and he's engaged in ongoing research on the philosopher Michael Oakeshott. He's spoken at a number of international conferences on this subject, and today, well, what he was originally going to do is simply bring Oakeshott's thought to bear on our topic. However, as you might have noticed, our lineup of speakers has changed slightly. Jonathan Price, very sadly, wasn't able to make it today. He was going to talk on the question, are we still political animals? And Robert Jan has kindly jumped to the rescue. So he's going to, his talk might not quite match his abstract, but it will match Jonathan's to some degree. He's going to give us a little introductory thought about whether we are still or can still be political animals before I gather moving into the thought of Oakeshott. So please give a very warm welcome to Robert Jan Winters.
Yes, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And can is it okay if I talk like this? Well,
yeah.
Okay. So first of all, thank you very much, Ralph and Mikolai, for inviting me once more. So as Ralph pointed out, I teach at the University of Leiden Law School, and I'm interested primarily in legal and political philosophy. And so I approached the topic of the human difference from a very different perspective compared to most of the talks we've had so far. So in particular, I'm not in any way qualified to explain how we got to be so different from other animals, which has been so which has been done so well by Ray Tallis and Merlin Donald in days previous. So fortunately, they've already shown very well, I think, that what makes us different is the fact that we inhabit what Dilthey called a geistige Welt, a cultural world that in some sense transcends our biology. So instead of talking about our biological roots, I will focus on part of the cultural leaves in Tallis's felicitous phrase that cannot be encompassed by these biological roots. So the topic of the mini-conference is the political animal, and the question posed to me was, how does living in a political community distinguish humans from animals, and what is important about this? Now, politics and political community are concepts we've inherited, obviously, from the ancient Greeks, and in particular from Aristotle, who, as Nikolai already noted, defined man as a political animal. Now, as Merlin Donald showed quite brilliantly, brilliantly, I thought, cultural change has been very, very rapid in the last millennia, and it seems to be accelerating still. So the world of the Greek city-states is very far away from us, and it's not immediately clear what we mean by politics in the context of the modern states that we find ourselves in. It's a sort of word, politics, that is used very frequently by many different people who all seem to mean very different things by it. And in fact, under the slogan, "The personal is the political," which was used by student and feminist movements in the 60s, the concept was broadened to apparently encompass everything to do with human persons, which is another way of saying that it has become an almost meaningless concept that does not refer to any activity in particular. As a consequence, the question I think at first needs to be reformulated in, are we in fact still political animals? A question we can only answer if we know what politics means in the context of the modern world. And I intend to use two models of the state developed by Michael Oakeshott, a 20th century philosopher and political theorist who was professor of political science at the London School of Economics from 1948 to 1969, to explore that question and to propose a tentative answer. Although Oakeshott is not widely read, I argue that he offers a philosophically sophisticated definition of politics that allows us to understand what it must mean as opposed to what we would like it to mean. So, that's a picture of the great man himself. And I'd like to start with what is referred to, or what I refer to as the ambiguity thesis. The modern state, Oakeshott argues, which began to emerge in the 15th century, is a thoroughly ambiguous constellation that reflects divided modern political consciousness. So the poles of that consciousness are usually designated left, right, conservative, liberal, progressive, reactionary, heaven, hell, or hell, heaven, and so on. And they reflect two opposing beliefs about the activity of government, about what it should and should not do. Therefore, he argues, it is wrong to speak of the state as if there were just one concept of it, when in fact there are two. And the empirical reality of modern states, he argues, is a mixture of them. Now, the words that I just mentioned, the words that comprise, as it were, our political vocabulary, like the concept of politics itself, don't seem very helpful immediately to understand it, because they are used in political rhetoric, acquire all sorts of different meanings, and no one uses them in the same way. So in the end, they become a bit useless, perhaps, as intellectual tools. So, as an alternative, Oakeshott proposes two concepts taken from Roman law, societas and universitas, which can be translated into civil and enterprise association. And these concepts stand for two modes of association, which is a technical term that means two categorically different ways for people to be related. Now, these models are ideal types, so models of a state that do not exist in pure form, rather like the sociologist Max Weber, who subscribed to a similar methodology. And so they're analytical tools that represent two opposed tendencies in modern political thought. And so it is important to understand, considering many of Oakeshott's readers think he's trying to describe the empirical reality of states. And furthermore, his aim is not really to recommend one ideal type over the other. It is to show how they can illuminate the experience of living in a state. So the government of a modern state is engaged in a twofold activity: making law, administering it, and applying the law to particular cases in a judicial procedure, and the pursuit of policy. And these two activities were known in the Middle Ages as the exercise of jurisdictio and gubernaculum. However, nothing distinguishes a modern state more from other historic communities, such as medieval realms or principalities, than the freedom with which it makes new law. It is a unique characteristic of a modern state to recognize the supremacy of the legislative act and to regard all other law, no matter how ancient or entrenched, as authoritative, simply in virtue of its not having been changed or repealed by legislative act. Thus, lawmaking became, during the transition from the medieval to the modern era, an everyday affair, and it came to be distinguished from a merely judicial process. And the main consequence was that legislation became an exercise not exclusively of jurisdictio, but of gubernaculum as well. So in other words, the medieval distinction between these two, jurisdictio on the one hand, gubernaculum on the other, became compromised in a modern state. And this historical development led to the formulation of different kinds of beliefs about the activity of ruling. And such beliefs are answers to the question, what should government be doing? And it's Oakeshott's contention that the miscellaneous collection of answers to that question, otherwise known as modern political theory, tends in one or another of two opposite directions of thought. Namely, the first, the activity of governing, consists of the business of organizing its subjects in the pursuit of a single premeditated end or purpose, which he calls enterprise association. And the second, the activity of governing, consists of the business of providing the conditions in which its subjects may pursue their own chosen and various ends, while still remaining a single association, civil association. So what Oakeshott means by enterprise association is the belief that the proper business of a government is to organize the energies and activities of a state's subjects and the resources of its territory for the achievement of a single premeditated end. And his belief is closely affiliated with the belief that the state is something like a natural community of human beings. The government is understood as the guardian or organizer of the solidarity of this community, a solidarity which is understood to spring from the pursuit of the single end or purpose. Now, all activities of its subjects will be permitted only in relation to the chosen end and only insofar as they contribute to it. In other words, in a state conceived on the model of an enterprise, nothing but the chosen end or purpose is regarded as being valuable in itself. And within this particular disposition of thought, certain limited variety of beliefs is permitted, and they will differ on the basis of the end pursued. Now, the circumstances in which a modern state emerged, Oakeshott argues, were such that to logically generate this belief about government, states emerged in circumstances of diversity, with various communities of different moral and religious beliefs living on its territory, and the first task of rulers was consequently to generate this solidarity. And this task automatically pushed the activity of governing in the direction of enterprise association. And furthermore, these rulers incorporated in themselves the whole of the authority which during the Middle Ages had been divided between the king and the church of the associations over which they ruled. States also acquired an ever-growing accumulation of resources, and the power grew exponentially as a result. One other prevalent circumstance in the last five centuries has been war, and war has always been an occasion for a government to turn in the direction of enterprise association. Now, during the 16th and 17th century, many states acquired colonies, which were regarded as estates to be managed, and ruling these colonies was usually done for the benefit of the parent state, and much of what was learned from this experience of colonial government was later adopted at home. Finally, enterprise association is likely to appear when a single problem presents itself as an end to which all other purposes must be subordinated, like victory in war, and often in the circumstances of modern Europe, such a problem has been thought to exist. And there were therefore many circumstances that led to this particular belief about the activity of government. Now, this belief manifested itself in several different idioms. Firstly, a religious form in which all activities, without exception, are thought to be subordinate to the end or purpose of righteousness. A historic example would be Geneva under Calvin. And there it was believed to be the business of government to create and maintain a substantive condition of things identified as righteous conduct among its subjects. And the ruler of the city was bound by no rules. He was considered to be the organizer of an all-embracing social religious purpose, and his duty was to permit no divergence from this purpose. Each subject was recognized as a servant of this purpose, an agent of the government, and such a subject had no rights save that of being ruled in this manner and to remain a member of the community. Now, secondly, there is a version we can characterize as enlightened government. In the 18th century, this belief spread itself all over Europe. And the most appropriate historical example would be the France of the Ancien Régime. And the first principle of this belief was that a ruler or government was the servant of a cause, and that the business of governing was to promote this cause as efficiently as possible. Later on, the cause came to be identified as a substantive condition of things called welfare or happiness, and the origins of the 20th century welfare state lie here. So welfare signified a kind of single uniform condition of things imposed by government, which included material prosperity and a large measure of security. And the value of all activities and enterprises was to be judged in relation to that goal. It formed a kind of secular counterpart to the religious form of enterprise association. So thirdly, a more specific version of this enlightened government can be identified as the belief that the end to be imposed by government and to which all other activities are to be subordinated is understood to be the maximum exploitation of the resources, the natural resources, a category that seems also to include the subjects of the state. And this variety on the theme of enterprise association was pioneered, or sort of things at least, by Francis Bacon in the 16th century. And the state is here understood as an economy, the managing director of which is the government. Now, fourthly and finally, there arose in the 19th century the belief that it is the proper business of government to be the organizer and director, not, as in the Baconian version, of the productive efforts of its subjects, but of the distribution of the product. And a substantive condition of things to be imposed by government was understood to be equality and security, and therefore the social purpose or common good of which the government was to be the organizer and director was a determination of how the national income was to be spent. Now, the other belief, the belief in civil association, is taken precisely the rejection of this view that it is the business of a government to impose an overall end or purpose on its subjects. It means literally government understood as the rule of its subject by means of law. More specifically, it can be understood as a belief that the proper office of the government is one to be the custodian of a system of legal rights and duties in the enjoyment and observation of which the subjects of the government may pursue their own chosen ends and purposes while still remaining a single association, and two, to be the custodian of the interests of the association in relation to other similar associations, so to conduct a foreign policy. Now, simply put, a civil association stands for a belief about the form, not the substance, of the activities of government. For a believer in civil association, it follows that what matters is how a government acts, whereas for a believer in enterprise association, what it does to promote the chosen end is significant. Now, that's not to say there are there are no laws in an enterprise association. Its government may choose to impose its single purpose upon its subjects by making and administering laws. However, in an enterprise association, rule by law is never valued on its own account. It is always subordinate to the substantive condition of things being pursued. Now, this belief about civil association arose out of the same context of circumstances, and we can make it intelligible in those terms. So every modern state, as we observed, began in diversity of the various communities of which it was composed and of different moral and religious beliefs and so on. And this diversity formed a kind of natural barrier to the understanding of a state on the enterprise model. And states also began in the enjoyment of a legal order, in fact, a system of rights and duties inherited from the medieval system, which defined relationships of subjects to one another and to their government. And only later was a purpose superimposed on this system of rules. Now, finally, in the 16th and 17th centuries, states became the battleground on which two or more diverse versions of enterprise association contended for supremacy, and to escape from the civil wars that arose, governments often turned in the direction of civil association. So, where in all this can we locate the activity that Aristotle called politics? And according to Oakeshott in his famous inaugural lecture at the LSE, Political Education, politics is the activity of attending to the general arrangements of a set of people whom chance and choice have brought together. And we see that this definition maps very closely on to the model of an enterprise association. So for Oakeshott, the very specific activity we call politics can only be understood on the basis of that model. So what we have here is a very clear and very specific idea of what political activity is, an idea that we can use as a standard to measure whether we moderns are still political animals or whether politics is an idea that we have allowed to slip from our cultural inheritance. Now, why is this an important question? Well, Aristotle, as Nikolai mentioned, thought that politics was necessary for human flourishing. And on the basis of this model, we can obviously understand that that's still the case. If Oakeshott's right, then you know the extreme version of enterprise association would be Nazi Germany and Soviet Russia. These two would be at the outer limit of the political spectrum, and we can see how a state conceived on that pure kind of model would be absolutely detrimental to human freedom and dignity. Now, as I said, the claim is that a modern state as we find it, so the UK or the Netherlands or Belgium, is a mixture of the two. So in that sense, the short answer would be, yes, we are in fact still political animals, because part of our political ideas correspond to this ideal model. If we want to really assess where a country is on the continuum, obviously that's a very, very difficult, very big question that I cannot undertake here. But I would like to end by making a couple of observations about things we see happening at the moment. So we seem to be, well, in the Netherlands at least, very much addicted to the goal of economic growth, and a lot of government activity seems to be directed to precisely to ensuring that we, you know, achieve at least a 4% per year growth rate or whatever. And you see that a lot of legal forms are being ignored in the pursuit of this kind of goal. One recent example was a government plan for reorganizing healthcare that, so they introduced a law that the Senate then turned down, what is the equivalent of the Senate, which is a second chamber in the Dutch parliament. And the government said, well, we can't have this because we have this agreement within the coalition that to reduce costs and get our budget through, we have to get this law through. And so so they submitted the same law, in effect, the next week with a kind of ultimatum and, you know, through some political wrangling, ultimately went through without consulting the second chamber. They introduced it in the form of more or less a directive. So this is one sort of concrete example where we see a definite tendency in a direction of enterprise association. And the second example is legal forms. So I've not had a chance to... actually, how much time have I got left?
Well, you can take up some of the questions if you'd like.
No, we can get into that. I mean, so what divides these models is a particular conception of what a law is for Oakeshott. And what it is not, in any case, I think, law at least as conceived on the civil association model, because so the contention is all the words in the political vocabulary have a double meaning, whether they belong to one or to the other model. And so a law is not what Oakeshott would call a technical regulation, which is a form of governing by goals, where the law specifically declares we want that you achieve this, for example, environmental reduction of emission in 5 years or whatever. So there's a problem of the legal forms, and this seems to be a very prevalent thing that's happening a lot at the moment, and that seems to point as well into the direction of this kind of management or managerial form of governing. So really, that's all I have to say. I'm interested in this model, and I'm interested in seeing if it works to sort of explain the situation we're in politically. And so...
So thank you very much, Robert Jan, for that talk. We have some time for questions.
Absolutely.
Do you want? Yeah. I believe Arlen's going to go around with the microphone. So if you wait for it to come to you before asking your question, so it gets to the film. So I can see that there's a question at the front.
Well, this does.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Robert. Just one very brief question. I wonder if you could take us through how Oakeshott thought both German fascism and the Soviet state are fundamentally alike, and are alike to such an extent that they can both be classed as enterprise associations.
Well, I mean, I understand it seems very counterintuitive, and obviously there are very important cultural kind of things and historical differences between the two movements. But the fundamental point I think he's making is that both subject and completely subject the human being to the purposes pursued by the state, whether it's, a communist utopia or, a racial utopia. It doesn't really particularly matter how people are getting exterminated by, it's the totalitarian model, whether it's fascist or communist, is on that basic principle the exact same. And so, I mean, it's a very obviously reductive kind of account. He just thinks that it tends to explain a lot of these tendencies that are, in historical aspects, very, very different, and that we obviously need all sorts of different ways of understanding, but it does capture a sort of fundamental tension in modern political thought and in the way states operate.
Could I just add, and then I think Raetalis might have a question afterwards, just a clarificatory thing. I got to the end of the talk and I couldn't quite remember the beginning. So how does Oakeshott's analysis apply to the Greek city-state? And what's just the fundamental difference between how it applies there and how it might apply
to the modern state?
Well, it doesn't apply to the Greek state in a sense that he thinks, well, we've inherited these concepts, but they mean something very different in modern times. So I can't actually do that out of my head, I think, but he has a whole analysis, historical analysis of what politics meant in the Greek context, and he just thinks it's radically different from the way we should think about it now.
Okay, thank you.
Ray, did you have a question?
Oh, thanks very much indeed for that talk. I associate Michael Oakeshott with the notion of small state and very modest aims for the state in terms of improving the welfare of the people. The more grandiose aims always end in tears. But I just wondered, how do you relate the balance of the two kind of the enterprise association, the civil association? How do you map that against, as it were, the size of the state? Because if we think of something like the welfare state, that clearly is seen as both a civil aim that reflects the wishes of individuals, but also as some kind of top-down government directive, almost. I mention it because it is something that is absolutely central to what's happening in the UK at the moment. Basically, the welfare state and the post-war settlement, it's all disintegrating even as we speak. If there's an NHS by the end of this afternoon, I'll be astonished. So I just wondered, is that a useful way? Do those two things map, the balance between these two kinds of association and, as it were, the size of the state?
Actually, I don't think it does. In fact, he was quite critical of conceptions of the absolute minimal state, and it's not a plea. I mean, it's not at all a plea for a kind of Tea Party political model. In fact, I think somewhere he calls the libertarians the lunatic fringe of modern political thought. And so, as I said, many people make this mistake. He was clear that he preferred the civil model to an extent, but in his later work, it's very obvious that he doesn't think it can capture the state, nor that it should. That there's always the question of balance, which he had a peculiar conception of philosophy, so he didn't think philosophers were in any way empowered to answer what that balance should be. He should just try and understand what this political community is like. So I don't think it maps really onto what the size of the state. It's rather how the state is run and how a health service, for example, is instituted.
I think there's a right up the other end there.
Thank you, Robert. And I may have missed this as you spoke, but with regard to the enterprise association, what kinds of ends did Oakeshott advocate that the state might organise us all? To what ends?
So what did Oakeshott think that the state should be organized for?
Yes.
Well, so we have to very much separate what he thought personally as a matter of politics. And he really does seem to think that, well, the state should really not do all that much, and it should really sort of keep the peace and allow people and communities that have more or less, well, that have spontaneously or whatever emerged to flourish. That's really the big idea. And so, in terms of the model, he would be very much in favor of a civil association that doesn't really do very much more than that on that kind of classical liberal model. But it, that's a preference in political sense that I don't think will disqualify the model per se if you disagree with. If that's in any way helpful.
I guess I had that sense about the civil side of this discussion, but the enterprise discussion, I had the sense of you saying that he was, firstly, this is ambiguous. We're in a world where both are in play. And to what ends might that, if the government is to organise the whole social association towards an end...
So on the enterprise model,
Is that the human flourishing you were talking about just then?
No. That would be what I refer to as, you have the four different idioms, and so it can either be a condition of where everyone's completely secure or cared for, or these are kinds of ideals that are postulated, or causes, as you would perhaps say, that a government is trying to achieve. And that will probably never actually achieve, but it's more about the direction that governments think in and what they organize for.
Well, because of the time limits we're working with, yeah. I think we had better move on. Yeah. There might be a chance to ask Robert Jahn another question at the end. There certainly will be after the mini-conference itself is over. So could I ask that we once again thank our speaker, Robert Jahn Winters?
Can you, and perhaps Robert Jahn, give out, we've got handouts here for...
If you'd like Father Conrad to come to the front and take a seat, and we'll have our assistants or organisers give out the handouts whilst I introduce. Okay, so as I explained earlier, in our original schedule for this event, we were going to have Jonathan Price come and talk on some of the topics Robert Jahn Winters has just spoken on. Unfortunately, late on in planning, it became impossible for him to make it. And so, heroically, Father Richard Conrad has agreed very late in the day to step in and to contribute a talk to this event. This was in the context, there was actually a small morning colloquium only a few weeks ago on a very similar topic. I believe the topic was, is the polis a fit place for a good person? At which both Jonathan Price and Father Richard Conrad spoke. So instead of getting one, we're getting the other, which I'm sure will be of equal quality and just as great a contribution to this event. So Father Conrad is the director of the Aquinas Institute at Blackfriars Hall here in the University of Oxford. He was also previously vice regent of Blackfriars Hall, University of Oxford, and all those who studied there at that time were very grateful to his benevolent rule. He has a PhD from the University of Cambridge It's in chemistry, isn't it? Yes.
Undeserved.
He has an undeserved PhD in chemistry from the University of Cambridge, and he now lectures in theology both here at Oxford and elsewhere. Today he's going to speak to us on the topic of the human difference and indeed the political animal from the perspective, I believe, of St. Thomas Aquinas. So please give a very warm welcome to Father Richard Conrad.
I'd like to thank Ralph and Mikawai for inviting me to stand in and hope that you'll find it interesting to hear a shortened version of the talk I gave at the conference a few weeks ago, where I set out Aquinas' vision of trustworthy political goodness, healed and enlarged and affirmed by caritas charity. It will give you a chance to see what a pre-modern thinker has to say about politics, one who's not just a philosopher but a theologian, and to find him, perhaps rather counterintuitively, affirming the business of politics. But before we get on to the actual talk, if you look at page 5 of the handout, this will help you in a way contextualize what I say within the aims of this Ian Ramsey conference and within a sense of the complexity of the human psyche. I've put on this chart the various faculties, or if you prefer, the abilities that are part of the human psyche as seen by St. Thomas. And you will see at the middle level that he has quite a high view of what you might call animal psychology and even animal intelligence. because he thinks that many of the animals, in a very complex and subtle way, are able to organize and interpret their sense experience. They have an imagination for retaining past sense experience. The cat knows that Mrs. Bloggs will feed it and Mr. Smith will kick it. And they have an estimative sense, the ability to detect meaning in their environment, like the sheep can have a sense of danger when it sees the wolf coming. And they are able to react in a complex way to their environment. And Thomas would identify 11 what I've called here emotions, but that's not really a good translation. 11 passions of the soul, responsive drives of attraction and aversion and meeting challenge and so on. All that animal psychology is part of human psychology and to be taken seriously, but it appears in a distinctive and a more agile way in the human psyche because it works in close cooperation with what you might call spiritual faculties of intellect and will, the ability at a higher level to transcend material conditions of space and time. And again, we have intellect in a distinctive way from the angels. They typically rest in the possession of truth, and we typically go through a reasoning process as we acquire more truth, and in that process there's a close cooperation between the spiritual faculty of intellect and the faculty of the imagination located in the brain. There's much more that could be said about that, but we will see a little bit later why that's important for considering the value of politics. So back to page one of the handout. Why might we suppose that St. Thomas would be rather negative towards the polis, the human political society and association? There's a family reason. His family was caught up in the Guelph-Ghibelline controversy. They switched sides to the papal side, perhaps in 1245, and his brother Reginald was executed by Frederick II and seen by the family as something of a martyr. Thomas knew at first hand that there can be tyrants who oppress people, and he talks about why God sometimes tolerates them. From the age of 5, he was brought up in a monastic environment at Monte Cassino, and he persists in saying that contemplation is, in itself, a nobler thing than action. But of course, maybe Aristotle says the same thing. And then, of course, there was his choice to join the upstart, scruffy Dominicans, rather than the respectable Benedictines, who were much more landed and stable. And in his greatest work, the Summa of Theology, he has a huge treatise on moral philosophy and theology, the Secunda Pars, and he starts by discussing what Aristotle calls eudaimonia, beatitudo, bliss, flourishing, happiness, and that, he says, does not lie in pleasure, wealth, political power, political honour. It lies ultimately in God. And at the end of the secunda, the second part of the second part, he seems to present the hermit as living the highest kind of life. But in fact, throughout the summer, you find in all sorts of ways that political life is good, positive, natural, and important. So he insists against the Albigensians that all that exists is good, including the material world and the human body. And then he says that hierarchy, differentiation, contributes to the beauty of the cosmos. And he takes from Pseudo-Dionysius that sense that in the hierarchy of the cosmos, from the highest angels down to the lowest living things, there's a beautiful cooperation where the higher orders help the lower, and the lower have an affection for the higher. And against some firmly held convictions of other thinkers, Thomas wants to say that in an unfallen world, if there had been no sin, there would still have been differentiation between men and women for the good of the propagation of the species, between adults and children, but also, more subtly, between adults with different abilities, different intellectual powers, and some would have been fitted to govern others, that there'd have been no slavery. So politics is natural. And then it's noteworthy that Thomas begins his moral treatise, the Secunda Pars, where Aristotle begins his so-called Ethics, which is really volume one of his Politics. He starts with the pursuit of eudaimonia, beatitude. And he says several times that Aristotle's eudaimonia, the fulfillment that comes from human political life, is valid as far as it goes. It's limited, it's fragile, it's not ultimate. It needs all the contributions that Aristotle speaks of, healthy life in a well-run society, but it's something positive and good. And it requires the virtues that Aristotle spoke of, the virtues acquired by practice. Thomas, as a theologian, as a Christian, goes way beyond Aristotle in thinking that God, by grace, pours new strengths of mind and character into us, all sorts of God-given virtues. And on occasion, he seems to say that they are the real virtues. But when he comes to define virtue, he thinks that much of the definition that he inherits from Augustine applies to Aristotle's virtues. He's keen on exploring how we acquire the Aristotelian virtues. And when he comes to discuss what you might call various departments of moral life in the Secunda Secundae, he very rarely distinguishes the contribution made by the acquired version of justice or temperance or courage from the contribution made by the form of temperance, justice, courage poured into us by God. In human life as she is lived, the two kinds of virtue seem to cooperate very closely. And that picture of the human psyche I gave in that diagram is clearly relevant to St. Thomas, because God's grace, God's work in us, takes flesh in this kind of psyche, in the fabric of human and social life. And so he gives a huge portion of the Prima Secundae, the more general moral treatise, to a discussion of the passiones animae, those animal drives that are part of our psyche, which we have to take seriously, and respect for what they are. So, for example, he discusses tristitia, sadness, depression, and the remedies for that are not pull yourself together and practice virtue. They are things like have a hot bath or talk to your friends. And nowadays he might say, see if you need some antidepressant drugs. And among the many virtues Thomas discusses, he includes magnificence, that Aristotelian social skill. So Thomas is very Aristotelian and gives virtues a key place in our pursuit of both human and divine happiness. It's within that overall pursuit of happiness that virtues have their place. And of course, for Thomas, there is much more. There's the personal guidance of the Holy Spirit to which we are attuned by various gifts. But it's within that overarching moral scheme that Thomas can discuss rights. Rights are not the starting point of his moral treatise. Neither is law, but law enters in as a huge, making a huge contribution to the business of the moral journey to fulfillment. So Thomas gives a huge place, but a limited place, to the Aristotelian life of virtue. And all of the virtues that he discusses, so to speak, take flesh in that human fabric.
So on page 2 of the handout,
you will see my summary of Thomas's treatment of law. It's noteworthy that he starts his treatise on law by seeing it as an act of reason, not an imposition of will. He's working before William of Ockham. He does not have that baleful modern picture that law is a matter of the powerful boss imposing his will on the subject. Law is an act of reason. The wise lawgiver is saying, in effect, see how good it is to do this and how damaging to do that. The lawgiver has power of coercion, but law is an act of reason. And legislators and politicians require special virtues, special forms of prudence, of moral good sense. And that's often very pragmatic. There are all sorts of pragmatic, subtle, awkward political decisions to be made, and virtue acquired and given by God is important there. Thomas, of course, has a huge place for natural law, which seems to be, and of course this is much debated, but it seems to be our rational ability to discern and prescribe what is truly humanizing. And of course, natural law has always been a huge part of Catholic moral theology. It's important for the Catholic moral theologian, important for the Christian, to recognize and practice what promotes human flourishing. Human flourishing is a big part of our Christian moral responsibility. That includes survival of the individual, the flourishing of the species, the goods of culture and religion. And Thomas sees human law, state law, as applying the natural law to shifting and particular historical conditions. And he has quite a high view of the dignity of law. It binds in conscience. Later moral theologians, I think mostly Jesuits, tended to think that some laws don't bind in conscience, like the laws about paying your customs duties. If you can get away with it, that's okay, but if you get caught, you have to pay the penalty the law prescribes. But Thomas thinks you shouldn't try and get away with it. He's even a bit un-Dominican in his valuing of law, because the Dominican constitutions don't bind under pain of sin. And Thomas might think that perhaps they do. He recognizes unjust laws. Sometimes you have to disobey the law. Sometimes for the peace of society, you might have to go along with an unjust law and maybe, for example, pay taxes over what is really just. But the default position is a respect for law, though without abdicating your reason, because he recognizes, with Aristotle, the importance of epieikeia, equity, applying common sense to know when exceptional circumstances require you to go against the letter of the law to achieve the purpose of the law. He's aware, especially as a Dominican, of the importance of dispensation. But he is so concerned for the dignity of political law and procedure that he thinks, again against some later moral theology, that if someone is holding on to something that by rights is yours, you shouldn't just go and grab it back, which is almost a kind of theft. And he thinks that in judicial procedure, the judge should do what the judge must do. And if privately he knows that someone is innocent, but the evidence properly publicly presented proves that person guilty, he should find the person guilty. I'm not sure that I agree with him on that. He recognizes prudence, if you like, in not changing laws too fast. Maybe modern governments and the EU could learn from that. He recognizes the value of custom as having the force of law. Many students of St. Thomas, many commentators, think that his general treatise on law is a bit abstract and doesn't flesh out how you get from the general principles of natural law to detailed regulations. In fact, Thomas gives us a huge commentary on the old law, the Old Testament, as a book of law, and there he seems to present the many detailed political, social, economic rules of the Old Testament as a kind of case study, an example of how every society in its own time and place must apply the natural law to shifting geographical, social, and economic circumstances, achieving, for example, in different ways, respect for the poor and help for the poor. And he even changes his mind through reading the Old Testament. In his book De Regno, he tends to present monarchy as the best form of law, but looking at the life of the people of Israel in the desert, he thinks that a mixed form of government, a bit like the pre-Tony Blair British Constitution, is the best form of government. where there's a figurehead, the best qualified have a role in government, and everyone is somehow enfranchised through elections. Sir Thomas has a high view of the value of law and politics for flourishing. And briefly, but importantly, this is reaffirmed by his discussion of charity. As a Christian, he places a huge premium on charity, agape in Greek, that God-given love for God above all things. He is insistent with the New Testament that charity inseparably involves love of God and love of neighbour, and that's partly because charity is a friendship with God. He applies, remarkably, Aristotle's view of friendship to charity. Friendship, philia, amicitia, for Aristotle, requires a kind of equality and reciprocity, and, amazingly, God lifts us up to be not servants but friends who can commune with God in a reciprocal way, not just known and loved by God, but able to embrace God by knowledge and love. And if God is our friend, then the same dynamic will operate as in human friendships. You share the interests of your friends. If they have unpleasant families, you will still care for their families for their sake. We share God's love, God's care, God's vision, God's delight for ourselves and those God gives us to care for, and distant people and nasty people, sharing God's thirst that they may become good and flourish with us in heaven. And then Thomas is a Dominican, not a Franciscan. He does not ask, to what extent would charity make you leave your family and give up wealth and embrace poverty? Although he did escape from his family into Dominican life and poverty, he asks how typically charity will make you love father or mother, children or spouse, and so on, more deeply and more purely. Charity, that God-given love, typically affirms and deepens and widens all your natural bonds. And even in heaven, when you see and delight in Our Lady and John the Baptist and the Apostles and other great saints, you retain a special love for those who shared the journey with you. So charity enlivens all the virtues and has practical effects in almsgiving, teaching, fraternal correction, making peace, opposing war, and so on. So as a theologian, as a Christian, who's committed to a journey into God, Thomas wants to incorporate in his picture all that natural goodness of acquired virtues, political systems, judicial procedures, law. And the love of God affirms all that and deepens and even divinizes the life of Christians in society, making them into good citizens. So I would like to share with you that vision of St. Thomas, affirming our nature as homo politicus. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Father Conrad, for that talk. We now have a short amount of time for questions, should there be any awaiting. We've got one just at the front here.
Yes.
If you just wait for the microphone.
Very interesting overview and a reminder of where much of our modern concept of law comes from. I wondered if we could leap from the medieval concept to the realities of the 21st century. Could you make a few comments on how, what we can learn from this meditation on Aquinas?
I think we have to recognize, as the previous talk said, how different a world we live in. Thomas, of course, was aware of different systems of government, the emperor, various kings, various free cities, and so on. So he's aware of the need to tailor your political thought, your political prudence, to different kinds of condition. He's aware that Christians can be good citizens of non-Christian states and share that project of making life more human. I think he might even be able to say that given the importance and the difficulty of political prudence, Christians can take part in government such as that of modern Britain, where you are working with people whose view is post-Christian or non-Christian. But I think it would be a big task to flesh out how the various virtues he discusses might have to be practiced in, say, modern economics, where Thomas can be rather negative towards usury, and its later thinkers, including, I think, the Dominican Saint Antoninus, who take a lot further that notion of a shared enterprise that allows the legitimacy of shared investment and getting returns. And I think there is a danger in modern times of separating what you might call private ethics, where you can be Christian and Aristotelian, from public political life, where you follow a different ideology or perspective. I think perhaps the big contribution that an Aristotelian Thomas would make is that we don't want to separate the public and the private in that way. Ethics, moral considerations are hugely important for political life, and Christians should be part of modern political life, plugging a Christian worldview that affirms all the natural good and the natural flourishing with which we can cooperate with people of different faiths and none. That's my kind of brief, immediate answer.
Perhaps I could jump in with a question. So I just wanted to ask about this idea of law being a matter of reason as opposed to a matter of a power exerting itself from the outside. And well, perhaps that relates to the question of flourishing. So perhaps you say that on that view, law is not a naturally at tension with flourishing. I suppose I just wanted to understand a little bit more about that topic and whether it really is the case that in modern times we think of law as something imposed from the outside. I suppose if you asked a legislator, they probably try to tell you it's not. And also I wanted to know, you mentioned it towards the beginning of the talk that he seems at one stage to represent the hermit as an ideal of human flourishing. Is the later view still consistent with that, or is the later view one on which
some degree of political participation, or perhaps in a similar kind of community, is necessary to human flourishing?
Well, to take the second question first, Thomas would clearly think of the church and society as a body. The church is the body of Christ, society is the body politic, and a body has to have different members with different roles. So he wouldn't want everyone to be a hermit. In fact, only a few people who've been through monastic life and proved they can live with other people have the right to become hermits. He's not keen on opting out of society. But within the body of the church, just as within the body politic, there is room for intellectuals and contemplatives. And the hermit is one of the many forms of religious life that enhance the body of the church and would represent for us the place there should be in the lives of all of us for a primary focus on God. So Thomas does think of charity as plucking some people out of the fabric of society into religious life, or even the life of a hermit. But more typically, charity affirms and purifies your family and political engagement. So that vision of the complex body, I think, would solve that second problem. The first issue of law as an act of reason is part of Thomas's prioritization of reason over will in the human being, so that will is not an arbitrary deciding factor that without rhyme or reason says out as a whim, oh, I'll have that today. Will is the ability to be attracted by the good that reason has perceived. So both as individuals and as a society, our business is to think carefully and make reasoned decisions whose attractiveness is due to their truth and beauty and coherence. And that happens at a social level, not just the individual level. And it flows from God. God is the wise lawgiver whose eternal law governs all things. And the natural law and human law is the exercise of our God-given share in God's own wisdom. We are able to reflect God's wisdom in running our lives, governing ourselves, so that wisdom and beauty and truth kind of filter down. And as something of a caricature, William of Ockham in the next century prioritizes will over intellect. God's arbitrary will becomes more important, and it seems to be reflected by the legislator's almost arbitrary will. And it's had, I think, a baleful effect on spirituality, where a number of religious orders, whom I perhaps had better not name, view obedience in a rather different way from Dominicans. And St. Ignatius, I think, said that we should call black white if the church tells us to. Whereas a Dominican would say, this is white and I know it's white. And Suarez, the great Dominican, the great Jesuit thinker, tried to follow Thomas, but had inherited a more voluntarist picture. So Suarez has to combine the two perspectives in a very different political world in the 17th century. And he thinks of law as an imposition of will, but for a valid law, the lawgiver must act reasonably. So it's been a big part of thought and spirituality, I think. And I think it can be refreshing to go back to St. Thomas, who seems to play will down in relation to reason.
Thank you. Actually, funnily enough, the speaker who was going to be here, Jonathan Price, told me that his doctorate is on
the rise of the will in legal thought in the sort of late modern age. So he'll be aghast to find out this started with William of Ockham, and his PhD is far less exhaustive than it should be. But we might have time for just one more short question, if there's one. Or Ray Tannis? Yeah.
Thank you very much for your talk.
If you just wait for the microphone, sorry.
Thank you very much for your talk. Just a quick observation. It was interesting that Aquinas felt that if you had inadmissible evidence, such as private knowledge, you would actually prefer the law above justice. Mm. And it reminds a little bit about Michel Foucault's observation that nowadays the law is everywhere and justice is nowhere. But I can understand how one would want to, as it were, privilege the law itself to uphold the principle of the law. But the thing that strikes me as a secular individual, from your beautiful presentation, I have a sense of mourning that a lot of the words that you have used have disappeared from political discourse. And one of the reasons they may have disappeared from political discourse, partly cynicism, I guess, but more importantly, I suspect they're probably being cut adrift from any kind of transcendental underpinning. And it would be nice to reintroduce some of the terms you've beautifully discussed back into our political discourse, but they are nowhere. I wonder if that's your impression as well.
I think that's right. I'm not an expert on modern thought. I tend to stop with the 13th century in my intellectual world. I am aware that, of course, virtue ethics is becoming more prominent again in modern ethical thought. But I have a suspicion that there is a big difference in, if you like, the instinctive worldview of many modern people and St. Thomas's worldview. And it's actually very difficult to get into a different perspective and see how it can be refreshing. It took me a long time, for example, to see the excitement of Thomas's insistence that law is an act of reason rather than an act of will, and to pick up the idea that the will is a passive faculty, a receptive faculty, the ability to respond to the good that reason has perceived. I think I picked up a lot of modern views of the will, and studying Thomas has managed to exorcise some of them. But I think there might be a slight sense of voices crying in the wilderness. But maybe we should keep on crying and cry more loudly.
Okay, well, if I could ask you all to thank once again our speaker, Father Richard Thomas. Do you think we should fill up a microphone?
Yes, and I'll start introducing.
Nikolai is just going to fill up the bottle so we can pour you some.
Excellent.
So we'll make sure you get some
whilst you talk.
So allow me to introduce our final speaker in the Humane Philosophy Project mini conference at the Ian Ramsey Center Conference on the Human Difference. And I also should make a confession. In order to try and make this look like an especially exciting event, I told you that we had a lawyer, a theologian, and a scholar of English literature, and you are all deeply impressed by the diversity of our speakers. So although this is true, and perhaps you thought, wow, it's quite unusual to have someone contribute to one of these interdisciplinary events from the perspective of English literature, I have to say that we're not actually going to break with that tradition, because Nick Prassas, although he did study English literature here at Oxford and graduated with a first class degree and a prize as well, I believe, and he also went on to complete a master's degree in the same subject, has slowly gravitated towards philosophy. And indeed, his master's thesis itself was in fact on John Ruskin's theory of beauty, which is a topic no more likely to be seen perhaps in our philosophy faculty than in the English literature one, but a philosophical one
nonetheless. However, having said that, I think on hearing him speak, I can be confident that you will recognize that this is a man who has spent a great deal of time with great books. and so I bid you to give a warm welcome to our final speaker today, Nick Prassas, who will tell us about Elizabeth Anscombe and human dignity.
Well, thank you for that truly embarrassing introduction. Is there anything into which I have to speak, or can
that's
I just...
fine,
just
I think.
Well, friends, comrades, let's get on with it. I begin with a quotation from that unduly neglected philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer. In the passage in question, taken from the second volume of his Parerga and Paralipomena, Schopenhauer offers a critique of one of the central doctrines of Kantian ethics, that of the dignity of man, which, so Kant alleges, gives to the human person an incomparable and unconditioned value. I shall quote Schopenhauer at length. If it were asked in general on what the so-called dignity of man rested, the answer would soon be that it rested on his morality, and thus the morality rests on the dignity and the dignity on the morality. But even apart from this, it seems to me that the notion of dignity could be applied only ironically to a creature like man, who is so sinful in will, so limited in intellect, and so vulnerable and feeble in body. And thus the supposed dignity of man, as Schopenhauer says elsewhere, is no more than a hollow hyperbole, a shibboleth for all perplexed and empty-headed moralists. And this is all good, tough, fighting stuff, I think. Now, it is the purpose of this paper to rebut Schopenhauer's calumny against the dignity of man, and in doing so to demonstrate that the ground of this dignity is to be found in what we at this conference are calling the human difference. I shall not attempt to defend the arguments against which Schopenhauer directed his invective, in part because I can't speak Kantian, which is a most difficult and obscure language, but also because it seems as though Schopenhauer's critique of Kant has real force. And I think if one wants to follow this up, one should read his essay on the basis of morals. Rather, I shall proceed along different lines, arguing for three theses which, taken together, explain both the peculiar eminence that man has among the creatures and further why we're warranted to speak without irony of his dignity. I shall argue first that man is a spiritual animal, which is another way of saying that he is endowed with reason or mind. Second, that being such an animal, he has the radical capacity to be the original source of free and rational activity. And third, that though he is manifestly finite and a contingent creature, the end toward which he is oriented and in the realization of which his being is consummated is an eternal good, and so transcends finally the world of man altogether. Now, corollary of these three theses, if admitted, is that the dignity about which we are speaking is not something we attain to, but inheres in the very substance of our being and our actuality as humans. Thus, the dignity of man is infrangible, being coessential with our nature, and will survive all manner of horrendous evils, whether inflicted or endured, being lost only with the annihilation of the human person that bears it. So I'm not talking about the sort of dignity we putatively ascribe to the dignified man, a sort of dignity one could lose by, you know, debauching oneself with inordinate alcohol, or the sort of dignity one might want to restore by giving a paper at a prestigious conference. I should add that I consider the three theses proposed in this paper to be intimately related and mutually implicative, though not strictly derivable from one another, so that were one to be rejected, the others would no longer be altogether intelligible, although they may be defensible when taken apart. Finally, it is my belief that, were the spirituality of man denied, and with it his freedom impugned and his end lost, I would find it impossible to conceive of any reason why we should arrogate an impregnable value to human persons. I would have to agree with Schopenhauer's errant student Nietzsche that the dignity of man and the equality we claim for all persons in view of it is a transparent lie told between slaves. No, so far as I can see, if we're to talk of dignity, the value that it imports, and the wrongfulness of those who violate it, we are plunged into the whole context of the sacred. That is the world of freedom, of spirit, of the good, and ultimately of the divine. Now, in arguing for the validity of these related propositions, I shall make recourse to the work of that philosopher who I believe did the most of those within the analytic tradition in the last century to uphold the dignity of man. That is Elizabeth Anscombe. For those who admire Anscombe, she appears as, to borrow from Gerard Manley Hopkins, a lioness breasting the Babel. She was a thinker of extraordinary capacities who defended tirelessly what she called the mystical value of man against all that was inimical to it in the philosophy of her contemporaries. Her work, being informed always by the belief that the realities of the faith cannot be shown to contradict the discoveries of reason, was, as John Finnis has rightly said, a paradigm of Christian intellectual life. Now, I cannot claim that I'm offering Anscombe's own account of human dignity. Indeed, to claim as much would amount to a libel. All I shall do here is to utilize and unite a set of arguments that are otherwise found in disconnection, distributed across various parts of her work. And so to our first thesis, that man is a spiritual animal. It is with some reluctance that I use the word spiritual, which is a rather opaque and often confusing word, as it resonates with echoes of still more dangerous words, like spirituality, which today means a sort of vague assent to a half-intuited something, and spiritualism, which is the habit of making such vague shows of assent. However, it is the word that Anscombe used, and it shall serve my purpose in this paper. By calling man a spiritual animal, I am arguing that the materialist conception of the human person, which is a doctrine so common that it is often assumed without argument, is incorrect. Now, it is as difficult to define materialism as it is to define matter, so I shall not try to encompass the materialist position with a strict stipulative criterion. I think it will do to say that the materialist, remaining at the level of the human person, would be committed to the belief that everything about man is explicable without reference to anything other than material features or parts or causes or operations. It's often believed that the only alternative to materialism, however it may be conceived of, is some sort of Cartesian dualism, which posits two incommensurable and isolable substances, one mental, the other extended, the relations and interactions of which constitute the life of the human being. What is especially unusual about Anscombe's defense of the spirituality of man is that it proceeds from a thoroughgoing rejection of the Cartesian position, though, and I should stress this is simply to appease our moderator, though I should add, I am not sure that the position Anscombe takes up is by any means incompatible with Descartes, or need exclude a theory that cleaves to the Cartesian or Wierian argument. Borrowing from Wittgenstein, Anscombe employs the example of a person pointing to a color of an object as opposed to its shape. I should say, when I wrote this paper, I didn't realize we'd have among us the great genius of the finger, Ray Tallis. So pointing to an object, pointing to the color of an object as opposed to its shape. Someone pointing in this way is, of course, carrying out a physical act, that of raising the arm and extending the finger. But as Anscombe puts it, no bodily action as such could manage to be this act of pointing to the color and not the shape. From the truth of this trivial proposition, Anscombe derives her thesis that the immateriality of the soul, the spirituality of man, as we're calling it, consists at bottom in the fact that you cannot specify a material character or configuration which is equivalent to truth. This becomes clear when we take a further, equally trivial example, that of a person who apprehends the validity of a basic arithmetic proposition, such as 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. If we had access to a complete account of the brain states at all the various levels of integration of the person in the course of their apprehension, we could not offer any material characterization, that is one that uses the language of corticals, nerves, neurotransmissions, and electromagnetic activity, that would be equivalent to the truth and meaning of the sum in question. There are a whole family of examples that confirm this point. Consider, for instance, intellectual or conceptual discoveries. Sir Andrew Wiles, the mathematician who resolved the problem of Fermat's last theorem 358 years after it was first posited, has spoken of how, in September of 1994, close to despair at the probable ruin of his proposed proof, he experienced a sudden insight as to how it could be salvaged. Now, let us suppose that at that very moment, forgetting for now the problems of positioning thought X in the physical time series, whilst had been subjected to a comprehensive brain scan. Once more, there is simply no sense in which any account using the language of biochemistry and neurology could be equivalent to the incipient proof, its meaning and its validity. If Wiles had died, could the scientist who conducted the brain scan have delivered the incipient proof or extrapolated from it what Wiles did? Now, Anscombe argues, we can hold that the above examples are instances of man acting qua spirit, without having to postulate a different sort of substance, an immaterial one, in or through which these acts are executed. Indeed, she would argue that in positing a further substance like that of Descartes' res cogitans, a sort of immaterial matter or subtle body, we will have failed to grasp what it means to speak of spirit and how radically incommensurable such speech is with the language of bodies. And so we can, or perhaps must, maintain a metaphysics of the spirituality of man's nature without involving ourselves in the apparent conceptual confusions of Cartesianism. My second thesis, that man is free and undetermined in his actions, is a correlate of his being a spiritual animal, as Anscombe saw. When B.F. Skinner wrote that book, Beyond Human Dignity and Freedom, he had intuited this relation. It's just he obviously made the terrible error of supposing that we should throw both out together rather than asserting the actuality of the two. Again, in opposing determinism and claiming for man the capacity unique within the world of the visible creation to be the cause of voluntary activity, Anscombe found herself outside of the main current of contemporary opinion. She was, of course, acutely aware of this. Indeed, in a short address delivered in Rome in 1986, Anscombe lists 20 opinions common among modern Anglo-American philosophers, including the propositions, one, that causation is equal to necessitation and is universal, so determinism is true, and two, that either there is no such thing as freedom of the human will, or it is compatible with determinism. She deals with these two propositions at length in her inaugural lecture as Professor of Philosophy at the University of Cambridge, a paper she entitled Causality and Determination. That it is indisputably true that the entire universe is wholly determined through and through, so that given a precise set of initial conditions, there can be only one possible total state of affairs at any subsequent moment in time, has become, as Anscombe puts it, a bit of Weltanschauung, and has formed a cast of mind which is characteristic of our whole culture. The reasons for this are diverse. Perhaps the most important was the extraordinary success of Newtonian mechanics, which has captivated the modern sensibility with its picture of the world as a corpuscular system composed of discrete particles, the motions of which are necessarily determined by strict laws. It is precisely this way of looking at things that William Blake described as Newton's sleep. Given the extent to which we are still inclined to think of the universe as fundamentally Newtonian or corpuscular, it seems this sleep still lingers about our eyes. Michael Dummett, whom I consider another paradigmatic Christian philosopher, makes a similar point, arguing that using the continuum of classical mathematics as a model of physical reality has led us to assume that the universe is a closed and determined system of magnitudes within which all causes are necessary, and so chance and thus also freedom is inconceivable. Both Dummett and Anscombe agree that the doctrine of determinism is not, as is often supposed, a presupposition or conclusion of scientific knowledge, but a metaphysical assumption the validity of which is altogether dubious. Once we have awoken from our dogmatic slumber and no longer assume that any causal proposition implies a universal statement running always when this, when then that, it becomes possible to get an adequate conception of human freedom, and so of our intrinsic dignity as free agents. Anscombe was, and I believe rightly, suspicious of the claim that total physical determination is in some way compatible with ethical freedom. Were the entire material world determined, human beings, which are, after all, living bodies sunk in the flow of matter, bathing in the universe, as Simon Weil would say, would necessarily be determined also. As Peter Geech has put it, if nature is bound fast in fate, then the human will is a chimera buzzing in a vacuum, feeding upon second intentions. Pretty good. Those who propose a compatibilist account of freedom tend either to be caught in some fatal contradiction or have mistaken freedom for what Anscombe calls a soft determinism, which is determinism all the same, as it involves the belief that everything except what actually happens is impossible. Of course, while causal indetermination is a necessary condition or premise for a coherent account of freedom, it is by no means sufficient. Man is free not just because we cannot predict what he will do, this would mean no more than his activity is haphazard, but because he can act in accordance with reasons and intentions. As our actions are, to use Anscombe's words, under the command of reason, though they need not always be reasonable, indeed they are often insane, we can be held to account for what we do. Were it proved that the activity of a human person can be predicted from non-rational causes, we could no longer impute those actions to him. Indeed, I would find it hard to understand why, if humans are not in this sense free, we should continue to speak of persons or of moral personality at all. As spiritual animals, endued with mind or reason, inhabiting a world open to possibility, the human person is free to choose how he acts, and in so acting, whether his life will be conformed to the goods proper to intellectual creatures or not. That his choice, to borrow once more from Geech, I rather like the husband and wife combo, may be in this way causa sui, or as Anscombe says in her paper on Chisholm, godlike, is intrinsic to our divine dignity. Now, I realize I've taken this a bit of a gap, so this brings us to our last thesis, that man is a finite being destined to embrace an infinite good. In her posthumously published essay on the immortality of the soul, which John Finnis, I think mistakenly, treats as a proto-paper later to be superseded, Anscombe proposes that, because man is a spiritual animal, he alone can get a conception of the eternal and become concerned with the eternal as an objective. This is an untimely thought, and when said today, is likely to draw contempt. Of course, I recognize I'm in good, untimely company. At least, perhaps I thought I was in good, untimely company when I wrote this. For ours is an age in which, as Anscombe so beautifully puts it, God has been exiled, though this epoch is, she contends, not alone in having been removed in this way from the Creator. And this, I think, is obviously true. Can one imagine a student arriving at Oxford and saying, as John of Salisbury said when entering the University of Paris, "Vere Dominus est in loco isto," the Lord is surely in this place. Of course, this does not mean that God's power has been constrained, that he has become smaller or changed abode. He is that which is, and so is not susceptible of change. Rather, what Anscombe means is that we have ceased to practice the presence of God, which is not the habit of entertaining, Ralph, I'm sorry again, it's not the practice of entertaining some Cartesian cogitatio about the Godhead, but rather a matter, and these are Anscombe's words, a matter of the ultimate reasons we could give, speaking truly, for what we are at any time doing. To live in the presence of God is to live sub specie Dei, knowing that we are seen by God and enjoined to abide by his ordinances, and that through our adherence to what he commands, we're brought into a more intimate and complete communion with him. It's when we no longer understand ourselves as beings before God that we become exiled from our spiritual existence. The moral vision of the exiled spirit, the moral vision of the exiled spirit suffers a dreadful contraction, so that our life in via is no longer understood, in the words of Georges Bonanno, as a struggle for eternity fought on the very verge of the visible world over the gulf of all light. Moral life is reduced either to a kind of philosophic calculus, such as that devised by Jeremy Bentham, all dolors and hedons, or some sort of bartering over what we owe to one another in order to get on. This dereliction of the spirit is catastrophic, as it is finally, I contend, the idea that man can involve himself in the life of God, or the eternal, and that his actions are not only free but redound into eternity, which grounds our belief that each human person possesses an incalculable value, such that to damage or destroy him is not just a matter of disutility, but a blasphemy. Anscombe makes this point very clearly in her essay on contraception and chastity. Here I quote Anscombe. It is this potentiality, this incredible possibility of the knowledge of God of such a kind as even to be sharing in his nature, which Christianity holds out to people. And because of this potentiality, every life, right up to the last, must be treated as precious. And I think she would also have said right from the beginning. One can hear in these lines the words of the second epistle of St. Peter, where the great apostle declares that man redeemed will partake of the divine nature. Those in the Orthodox dispensation speak of this union of the created person with the love that is God as deification or theosis. The same doctrine is found in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, where it's stated that the only begotten Son of God, wanting to make us sharers in his divinity, assumed our nature so that he, made man, might make us gods. And this idea of union, so intimate as to involve a real participation of the creature with the divinity, is not an exclusively Christian thought. Indeed, one can find the same claim that man can become like unto gods in Plato, as in Theaetetus 1:7-6b, in Aristotle, which some people perhaps find rather unusual, but in Book 10 of the Nicomachean Ethics, he says we must side with all that is immortal in us. And also in Plotinus, in the Enneads, in the 6th Ennead, section 9, that we must become deiform, godlike, to see the divinity. Now I should mention also the prevalence of the same doctrine in the Bhakti set of Hinduism, a doctrine which is so wonderfully enshrined in the most beautiful portion of the Mahabharata, the Song of the Lord, or Bhagavad Gita. And so to conclude, having attended to the three theses proposed at the beginning of this paper, and in doing so described at once the human difference and our human dignity, it is time, as I say, to conclude. One of the great achievements of Blaise Pascal, about whom I haven't been able to speak this afternoon, but whose genius as an anthropologist cannot be overstated, is to have shown that we will never understand man if we do not assert at once how dismal and how great he is. Great by nature, being, as we are told in Genesis, the imago Dei, dismal through the wounds he inflicts upon himself when he falls to the madness of sin. We cannot but hate, and we cannot but love what we see when we look into the world of man and consider that perplexed and perplexing creature. For though he is frail, hanging between infinities in relation to which he appears as if nothing, and though his heart is bent unteachably after evil, indeed is so deformed as to suggest that he is implicated in some terrible aboriginal catastrophe, and though the world he has made with his brother man has fallen so far wide of its good that we cannot long contemplate it without despair, it remains a destiny of man to become, as Christ said in the Gospel according to John, a friend of God, to be to God not a slave, but an adopted son in grace. He is an heir to unimaginable beatitude, a creature made to participate in the life of the Godhead, which is, as the saints have known and made known, eternal life, eternal consciousness, and eternal bliss. Such is the nature of man's dignity. And it's for this reason, finally, that we must strive indefatigably to remove and to destroy all that would seek to violate this dignity, and in violating it would have us believe we're less than what we are. Thank you.
Here ended the lesson.
Actually, you've still got to answer questions.
Oh,
old boy.
Gosh, yes, of course, yeah.
Well, thank you, Nick, for that talk, and I'm sure everyone understands what I meant when I said at the beginning that they perceive your literary background in your talking. We actually...
even going right up to the end, we only have about 6 minutes, according to my watch, for questions. So are there any to be asked? If we just wait for the microphone.
Very nice paper. I enjoyed it immensely. I have to say that the question of spirituality is a very interesting one, and the notion of where it comes from. Because, of course, in all of our conventional conceptions of the human mind, at least hierarchical conceptions, whether evolutionary or developmental or simply structural, which would be the, let's say, the Humean approach, the spiritual is, in a sense, difficult to place, because in the one hand, it appears to be, in this kind of a discussion, one of the highest, most abstract achievements of the mind. On another level, it seems to be attributed as almost as an intuition, as something orthogonal to intelligence, as we sometimes conventionally define it, at least in terms of analytic skills or whatever. It's certainly true that the majority of human beings, in my experience, are very pragmatic. You know, the point of view, there used to be a little journal, I don't know if it's still published, it was called the Worm Runner's Digest in psychology, and it was a very, one of puncturing balloons. It was I wouldn't say it was cynical, but it was very ruthlessly putting down almost any kind of pretension about what you could conclude from any kind of empirical study.
Yeah.
And spirituality is sort of the ultimate subjective term, very difficult to document from the outside, of course. Is it possible that the origin of spirituality is in community? That is to say, part of my own argument is that, of course, all the tools we use to achieve such ideas come from community, from our relationship with community. And I just wondered whether you could comment on that.
Community.
Well, let me just flesh it out. If symbols themselves,
yes,
including languages,
yes, I see, yes,
conventions, everything else, comes from community, and you rely entirely on immersion and assimilation of that community. In a sense, you're doing the work of the community when you think everything that you produce is flowing into you. As you say, Shakespeare is, as it were, a vortex in the middle of Elizabethan society that sucks up everything and then spits it out in a certain form. Is it possible that the subjective experience of that vortex is what you're talking about?
Yeah. Well, it's a thought to wonder at when you consider about the emergence of language, because it would necessarily involve a simultaneous apprehension on the part of two subjects of a meaning that before presumably was only incipient, something like that. So yes, I agree with you. I think there is at the root of all of this community. But I also think that because I'm very dubious of this idea that any of us are in any real or useful sense individuals. I'm sort of with St. Paul, where, you know, you are not your own. This is the great, I think the, well, I think one of the most terrible thoughts is this idea that a man could make himself. And I think that usually is at the root of most sins. One is free and independent in that sense from, as you say, the entire community. I'm afraid it's a bit garbled, but it's certainly something I'd like to think about.
Well, we can get in one short question or two extraordinarily short questions.
Excellent. What about the answers? Just a grant.
Oh, Nikolai, sorry, you did say
a short
question.
One, but I'm happy to concede if somebody in the audience has a short one as well. If not,
time's running out, we better go.
If not, I wonder whether you'd how you'd comment on this from an Anscombean perspective. So obviously Anscombe is not satisfied with the sort of compatibilist approach to the question of human nature. Would she be equally dissatisfied with trying to find a place in the physical world for free will through indeterminism?
No.
So, you know, sort of fundamental quantum indeterminism being the foundation for how free will is possible in the world.
I think an interesting comparison here is with Dunnett. In the paper that I quoted, Dunnett says very plainly that quantum mechanics makes it no more feasible that there is such a thing as free will. That actually we can arrive at the truth of, or rather the falsity of determinism quite without any of these transformations, whereas Anscombe actually believes that it was indeterministic science of the most fundamental level of quanta, that actually finally burst open the Newtonian prejudice and actually avails us of some sort of evidence at the most profound level that determinism is a dream, really.
And on that note, I'd like to ask everyone to thank once again Nick Prassas and our other two speakers in this mini conference.